Robinson, Miss Martha Davis, Mrs. Minnie Clark, Mrs. Maxine Hensley, Mrs. Margaret Armstrong, Mrs. Estelle Hilton, Miss Charity Wells, Miss Frances Hale, Mrs. Bernice Dixon, Mrs. Inez Stanley, Mrs. Mamie Bonds, and Mrs. Dorothy Nix.
Motion made to ask Mr. Ralph McClellan to serve as legal consultant
for the District 9, Hampton Davis. Motion carried. Motion for adjourned at 8:30 p.m. submitted by Elizabeth Dixon. I move that the minutes be approved.
Madam Chairman, I request that you must have been late.
No, I just did pay me the recommendation.
Well, that was, we didn't know you were here since we didn't hear.
I see Charity Wells' name on the press.
Was she a teacher?
Hey, Captain.
Wells and,
any other corrections? Now that we have a forum, I'd like to say that I'm glad all of you made it out on such a day of night. Didn't expect so many of us were. It's really hard. Is there a second to Mr. Dixon's motion that we accept the minutes?
I think.
Kind of correct. As corrected. All in favor, please say aye. Contrary, no. Motion carried. We have some communication minutes.
One from Miss Lang, a little note there.
Well, this is from Mrs. Elizabeth Langford. Dear friends, thank you for your card of sympathy. It is so comforting to hear from friends in an hour of sadness. My family joins me in appreciation of your thoughtfulness. Sincerely, Elizabeth Langford. Allied Medical Careers Incorporated, the 5th annual convention of the Allied Medical Careers Club of Georgia will be held at Epworth House, St. Simon's Island on March the 22nd, 23rd, 24th, 1963. It will be attended by over 200 student members. This is an excellent opportunity for promotion of and recruitment for the many paramedical professions. The exhibits will be set up after 5 p.m. on Friday, March the 22nd, and will stay up for 24 hours. Part of the program on Saturday will be the reviewing of exhibits 11:15 to 12:30. The exhibits will be made more meaningful by panel discussions planned for that day. The exhibit fee is $2.50. If you plan to exhibit, please send a check for the amount payable to the Allied Medical Careers Club, Incorporated. And information related to the size and for the type of exhibit. If you plan to spend the night, single room accommodations, $3 to $6. Meals are available at reasonable cost. For room reservations, contact Gwendolyn Biggerstaff, Prophet Hospital. The above arrangements should be made by March the 18th.
Thank you, Ms. Dixon. Ms. Carolyn Atkins will represent the 5th District at this meeting. Maybe she'll bring us back an interesting report. Help keep down the pillow fights. Is that the problem?
We understood they're very strict. also the auditor's report, and if we're going to print them in the next meter, I put the district in the meter, but he didn't carry it this time. In the meantime, we got the one from the registry if they want to wait and have it all printed or just give the totals, whatever they'd like.
Just give the totals right now.
Whatever the group would like to have, it will be, both will be printed in this entirety.
February 63 brought forward from January $2,609.22. Receipts $6,687.50 for a total of $9,298.72. Disbursements $5,548.63. Clear in the bank $3,750.09. And this agrees with the bank statement of $5,492.92. This is the district.
tomorrow, and we have seven applications to be approved.
approved and we carried on the routine activities of office. I think our system is working out very well with the tabulated cards.
Did you report the numbers you have?
700, well, the 76 came in today. I didn't pick up the mail yesterday because I had to clear up and get everything else, so we got 76. 76 with six applications, and we already had one.
776 members. Middle of March. Isn't that wonderful? The secretary reminds me that we have to dispose of the auditor's report. It was not read, but I think published in the media, the auditor's report. Ms. Hicks, the 7th. Any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
I want to tell them they're setting a new system of our auditor's report, so don't get alarmed if you see a estimated budget and then something else differently. And actually, they estimated 32,000 for us to take in. We took in about 8,000 more. So we are still in order with everything. It's just that we did some better than we expected to.
Thank you. Is there a report? Did Ms. Bryce send in a report from the committee?
Ms. Burns will speak. She tells of her experiences in Samoa. Gave a very interesting talk out at Emory, and it will be at 7:30. As you notice, we had a little error on the meter stating 4:30, but we corrected it. And she should give us a very interesting program. Yes.
We've had some calls about that, haven't we? Some of them didn't notice that the correction was made.
I don't know why, because I put 1,186 of them through the machine, the mimeograph, to make that correction. What happened when I got ready to go to press, I had no meeting notice. I had nothing about the nurse of the year, which was promised at noon, and everything happening at one time, so it did right well to even get the paper out. And I happened to catch it just as it came out on the 1st, and in lieu of time, since the 6th was the deadline, I had to come in on the 1st and make those corrections and get them in the mail immediately.
Do you have anything to report on printing?
Printing, we had 1,500 copies of the meter, and 1,000 copies of your rules and regulations for the registrar are on order. The corrections have been made. We talked to Fred about them again in the morning.
That was how many district meters?
1,500. Now, all the meters that went out were corrected, with the exception of about 5 that I put in with Ms. Garland's material. As you see, those were some that the mimeograph ran into, and I addressed them by hand.
Rules and regulations, but not the bylaw.
For the registry.
No, those, the bylaw committee, you know, told them to have reprints made on the others with the.
And passed on those two that were deferred, which their references were
We have had two meetings, one January the 22nd and one February the 19th. And if it's all right with the board, since I have several recommendations here, I would like to have each one discussed separately because they aren't related to each other. In the January the 22nd meeting, we have $500 in our budget for the educational fund for the private duty nurses to go to the surgical congress and the American College of Surgeons and, well, anything, any ANA meeting that is relevant to education, anything. And the committee wanted Mrs. Maxine Hensley and Mrs. Emma Zerks to be sent to the Southeastern Surgical Congress in Miami, which would be held March 18th. And that's my first recommendation. Yeah, I appreciate it.
I'm going to approve this recommendation.
Is there a second? Okay. Any discussion? All in favor of this motion, will you please say aye?
Aye.
Contrary, no. Motion's carried.
Who's second?
That's it.
Now, the recommendation of February the 19th meeting, Mrs. Hazel Whipple represented, she was one of the individual representatives on the committee. And she has gone to work for Emory, and she resigned. And the committee wanted Mrs. Virginia Markey to represent one of the individual members on the list.
Discussion. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. This motion is carried.
Now, another recommendation of February the 19th. We have two telephones at the register, and they both ring practically constantly, I understand. And it was discussed that a light system be installed on the second phone to where the light would come on instead of the ring when the registrar were talking on the phone to somebody. It's so distracting. So I want to explain that. And the recommendation is that a light system be installed in the second telephone to replace a ring of a second phone with the rich.
You have the money to take care of them.
Well, I hope so. We have things in the budget, so for miscellaneous, for expenses.
$5.
It's $5 a month.
Those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The motion is carried.
Now, in the February the 19th meeting, the Practical Nurses Registry Committee, which consists of five members, requested that they meet with us. And now, sort of go back last fall, we began having a lot of complaints about the practical nurses wearing white hose and caps on duty that work from the registry. And all this is the ones that work from the registry. And so when we sent out the statements in December, we sent a little memorandum
this year, and also that it was against the rules for the practicals working from the rest to wear white hoods and caps while on duty in the hospitals that have schools of nursing and also in homes. Now this goes back to a ruling in 1954, and a couple of years ago, Ms. Atkins sent out memorandum notices to the hospitals asking them, nursing services, asking them to cooperate with us in this. So the Practical Nurses Registry Committee requested that they have a meeting with us. And of course they want to wear the white hoods and the caps on duty. Now they met with us and it was discussed. Ms. Garland was with us. And then when they left, well, this was a recommendation from the executive committee of a private duty section and also from the registry committee of the district. It asked that all licensed practical nurses working from the nurses' professional registry to abide by the rule of the registry, which reads that practical nurses on the registry not be allowed to wear caps and white hoods on duty in hospitals with training students or in the homes, and that any infringement of above rule by the practical nurses calls for immediate dismissal, and that the chief registrar be asked to enforce this rule. And it was also recommended that the registry not accept any new licensed practical nurses applicants that have been licensed by waiver. We have around 125, 135, I don't know the exact number, of the practical nurses that work from our registry that came in under waiver. And so many of them are older people and people that practically really should just be sitters. But, I mean, you can't just, you know, get rid of them when out of town. But I'm just trying to explain a little bit about it. And I read to the practicals and the registry committee from the bylaws about the registry being a professional registry and being a registry belonging to the private duty nurses. And of course they work up there, but they don't assume any responsibility or anything, and we feel that they should abide by the rules set up by the registry. So I was bringing this to you all tonight.
Now, Chairman, I'd like to speak on this motion. Some hospitals and families, I have a problem with the practicals as much as some others. And we have one hospital in town where it really is a very bad situation.
is getting that complaint generally, not just.
It's not only the doctors, it's the patients, family, the floor, and the visitors, and just everybody.
Is the second amendment to the main reason for?
Yes, it is, and then too, I think, and I guess the girls think, that they just shouldn't try to do something that they don't. That's what, you know, that's what I get about.
We're trying now, getting the practical nurse that was told to by the practical, didn't know her name. And she's not acting enough, and didn't stop complaining about it, she hung bragging the other day about how much she don't need. And the family made the checks out, and they paid her $9 for 5 days, and she was alive. As long as they function, she's a little like. So this girl is trying to find her, she's super, and she's going to get her back, and we're going to pray for her. But it is very misleading, and it seems to be quite a problem in one of the hospitals.
Yes, ma'am.
And we're not trying to tell hospitals what, how their.
We're talking about the practicals that work for mileage, that's all we, I make this recommendation that, I say. Well, see, they don't go to Piedmont, and they don't come to St. Joseph's.
They're not supposed to.
And, that's.
Is there a task for practical verification, leaving that on still in the clause that those who go, it would give the impression those practical nurses who go to hospitals that don't have screws, and where we have the plateaus, or is that in the deal? Would seem to me to be a little sound that is coming from the registry to make this for all nurses on the registry, is make it uniform.
And just scratch that out.
Well, that's what we would like, but we aren't.
The practical nurses on the registry not be allowed to wear caps and white hose on duty, period.
I think this would be a little inconsistent, if this is going to be a regulation, just put a duty, if it would make a question.
Madam Chairman, I would like to ask one question. It seems to me that several years ago, there was a rule made that all practical nurses who worked from the registry, even though they were those especially the Wainwright licensed practical, if they stayed on the registry, they would be required to take the 292-hour credit Smith Hughes. Well, then no other Wainwright nurse should be even allowed to put on, to come on the registry under that rule.
Or?
I think there's an occasion there, though, that these are still practical nurses that have their license by waiver. This is really just the.
This is just.
Nurses are developed.
Oh, that's right, but the rule was made originally. The reason I know the background, I spent 6 months working in the field about all the practical nurses, and that recommendation came after all that information was collected. And it was made for all the purposes that you say to bring practical nurses up to a certain level in order for them to start.
I knew that the letter be written to the Chattanooga Association. And stage that down.
I thought we'd already heard that.
We haven't voted on this, we just been talking.
Oh, I thought it was our vote.
Are you ready to vote on this recommendation? Any further discussion? Mark, you got anything?
No, I thought we voted on it.
No, we did. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. We have voted.
Now, you want to take up this one?
Well, Ms. Dixon has one, she wants to.
Yeah, you go ahead with your recommendation, Bobby.
And that the registry not accept any new licensed practical nurses applicants that has been licensed by waiver.
Well, now, does that mean even though she's had the 292 hours? You might get
a new one.
You might miss some good practical nurses.
Well, I'd like to see.
You know, it was good enough for the extra hours, Ms. Nolan, up there.
Yeah.
They live in practical nurses and they're not even teaching courses for the nurses that came in from way to there.
What they do, they say they're going to take it, you know, and maybe they'll start and then they'll drop out. I mean, there's so many people to keep up with, you can't keep up with all of them. And I've talked to several people and they recommend that we raise our standards of that for the applicants. If that's what's the matter, one of the things that's the matter, that our standards should be high for the people who are private duty from the registry. And that one way would not have them come in and wait.
Is there any further discussion on this motion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. This motion is carried. Now, Ms. Dixon, you go to your motion.
I move that a letter be written to the Chattanooga Association setting forth the problems that found in their uniforms and ask that their association plan a uniform that is not white, so as to know that it is that police. How do I want to?
I would just like on the phone to write them a letter.
For me.
Stating the action taken by the board tonight, and suggest maybe that they are playing in some different uniform than what they're wearing their suit.
Did you want a second, Ms. Dixon's motion then, ma'am?
Well, let's
go with right 11.
That a letter setting forth the action of the board and state the problems doctors and families are having in identifying the practical nurses. So that is?
Yes.
Oh.
appropriate, you,
I'm gonna pay back the leases. Let's just tell him that the code couldn't do, Motion made by Glover, setting forth the action of the board and state the problems doctors and families are having in identifying the practical needs, and give consideration to a covered uniform for the, nurses in your association. Does that do it? I got in their association.
Ms. Hanson, the second of this motion. Is there any discussion on this motion? Those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. Karen, do you have anything on public relations?
We did the visit all the hospitals during the time for Nurse Week, and we took out the approximately 1,500 nominations to the major hospitals, and we're planning on a big program, TV and full coverage for Nurse Week, May 12th.
Ms. Wells, you have a report on the American Journal of Nursing?
I've sent in about 35 subscriptions for you. 21 in January. Then we got in 3 today.
You have a good report.
It's wonderful to come through this
year. Well, it certainly is a bargain. I was glad to take advantage of it this year. We do have a report on the careers.
Anything about careers was handed to Ms. Jones intact. I mean, none of it was open when it was addressed to 5th District. We had no knowledge of whether it was for a nomination or what, just in order to see.
Could we wait and I'll think a little while?
I think she wants them right back. She called again today about
it. Let me ask you, if we're going to have Nurse Week in May, and this is just the middle of March, we're going to take an awful lot away from Nurse Week in May by selecting a Nurse of the Year now. And couldn't the board authorize this committee to hold up any information, or couldn't the board hold up this electing a member until nearer so as to stimulate more interest? And it probably would help stimulate interest if you just say the board's held it up and won't act on it until later.
You will
so
have
that
a board meeting.
Who's the Nurse of the Year? Because as sure as you do it here tonight and it's announced, that person's going to know before she goes to bed tonight she's been elected for Nurse of the Year. And it's going to take away a lot of interest.
Well,
the board committed.
She says that she will still accept the nominations, and that I don't understand. I was notified that the ceremony would be on May 16th. I have not had the minutes off the meeting. I couldn't attend, but I was told that the deadline was the 6th. I told them the meter would be out on the 1st, and it was with every effort that we could get the meter in time to even get it out. It came in on the 1st, in fact, the day before the 1st, and was in the mail at 1:50 on the 1st, and many of them didn't get it until the 5th. Now, the bad thing about this, I asked her, was it going to be closed, and she said, well, if any more come in, we'll take it. Well, if you're making the nomination now, and you get more, and they're going to accept the others that come in after the 6th. Many people have been unhappy because they feel that it's taken away from the program, that the impetus is to get nearer to the time, you know, that it would be that much more. And we do have a board meeting before the 16th. You see, we have one in May.
Madam Chairman, I feel very strongly that all sections should have adequate time to really give this thing serious consideration. This is quite an honor. And every section, as a rule, if they think about it, has somebody that they would really be interested in nominating. And for instance, if this is, I think we should be allowed more time. And for instance, in private duty, we have nurses in every hospital. It's awful hard to make contact and get around, and it takes time. Then you have to get all the additional forms. It seems to me like that this is just a thought, but I would like to board to think about it. It's all right to have a yellow form and have somebody nominated and have a couple people endorse them on that. But why couldn't we, instead of having to have a yellow form for every extra vote this person gets, why couldn't we have another form attached to the yellow form where different people could sign this, that they do agree with this yellow sheet to it that they want to nominate this so-and-so. And I really would appreciate very much that we have some extra time on this. And as far as the board could vote by mail if necessary on this thing closer to the date. And I think this is too soon to make a selection. And I think in fairness to all the nominees and to all sections that we should have more time. And I would like to recommend that the board hold up the ballots for the Nurse of the Year award until, I think at least that could it be done as late as April the 15th? I mean, we had our voting in April the 15th.
When is the next voting?
It's in May, before the meeting. You see, your meeting ordinarily would be a little before the 16th. And Florence Nightingale's birthday is on Sunday the 12th. Which means your ceremony is on the 16th. Our meeting should have been about the 9th of May. So you have a board meeting a week before the award, the ceremony. You have one in May.
That would give time to cut and grade and so on.
There's going to be another program for the next, the search by the most outstanding news in Georgia. And that is going to be the second week in August, and that is to be done by the Allstate Insurance Company, who are giving 2 scholarships. And the registered nurse, all districts will be asked to participate and send in at least 1 name from a district to a local group here in Atlanta to work with this insurance company. And I don't know what the criteria for the nurse is going to be, but we have this in May, and of course whoever is selected in May can still go up for the nurse of Georgia, outstanding nurse of Georgia. But it seems to me that we do need more time, because first place you need to know what this insurance company is going to have for that criteria for selecting this nurse, so that you don't waste your election nurse here. And then she wouldn't qualify for your state.
Well, of course, it wouldn't have to be that way, though. I mean,
but it would be nice.
Actually, if the person qualified, they could just be the automatically be the district nominee.
Well, the 1,500 nomination sheets were printed in Ms. Garland's office the very next day after the meeting. We were tied up in our 5th district office. Her secretary did them, and she brought them to me on Monday, and I got out Tuesday and visited all the major hospitals Tuesday and Wednesday. The smaller ones and the ones of great distance, like Brawlers and other places, I had to mail them to them, and the letter went to all of them. But as our program grows along, the interest from two months from now until May, when we're trying to get published in the newspaper and television and so forth, that's the point that I'm concerned about. They were all notified, and we gave them the instructions, and we did distribute the 1,500 nominations.
Hospitals and agencies.
All hospitals and all health agencies, and to the members of the board and to the schools of nursing, everyone.
Well, if the board voted on these now, on if they made a selection now, what would happen?
Well, she says she's still going to take nominations if they come in after the 6th. So that, I don't understand how you can close a nomination and then accept more afterwards after you've already voted on it. And we received one the other day. However, Ms. Hudson is not eligible on that. It's in there. It came in. Someone brought it by the office Monday, and having won it the first time, she wouldn't be eligible, but had it been a candidate that wanted it, she told me she would accept any that came in late. I know I got out of bed and went to town and got them for the meeting they had last Friday, and all had been turned over.
As I understand it, you see, you're voting for place, for position here. There's 11 candidates here, and if you vote Alma Clark Barrett won first place, right? Somebody else might vote 4 or 5 over there.
Right.
And then this goes back to the committee, you see, to decide from this who gets first place.
Your meeting ordinary would be May the 11th, but that means your board meeting is already scheduled for May 8th. So that would still give you time. Wait, Sam, I'm looking 62. I'm looking the wrong year. Please excuse me. I'll throw that one out tomorrow. Well, now let's see, the meter has your schedules at all. Now we left, it would have been, that still doesn't tell you though, because we left it open on May.
The convention.
May 12th is Sunday.
Is May the 13th through the 17th, and the pre-convention board meetings are the 9th, 10th, and 11th. And when do we meet the?
You're supposed to meet the second, Tuesday.
The second Tuesday, if Thursday. The convention week is the
14th. Your regular meeting would have been the second Thursday, and your Tuesday before the second Thursday. I've got those, but I...
Well, your second Thursday, the first of the month comes on May. Your second Thursday is the 9th of May.
That would make it the 7th, then. It's scheduled for the 7th.
So probably the first of the week.
Here it is.
Have those calendars I gave you last time? I should have put myself one here.
If we were according to schedule, our next meeting would be the second Thursday, which is the 9th of May. Then
that will put you the 7th of May.
I wonder if the board members that are going to that lead convention.
But now this, the 12th is going to be, this is going to be next year.
But your regular meeting would have been May the 9th, and your board meeting is scheduled for May the 7th.
Why couldn't we have May the 16th for the district meeting?
Well, they've got the 16th scheduled for your ceremony.
For the ceremony.
Yes, We left our meeting open for May for that, and they've already scheduled the medical academy for the 16th.
Mm-hmm.
So that would mean that on the 7th that you'd have a board meeting. That's when we're scheduled. I know I've got a calendar someplace, but I guess it's...
Tell me this. If this is a contest, and if people are sending in the names, why wouldn't all the names put in a...
What happened the first year Ms. Jones was in was chairman and it was ballot. The second year it wasn't.
Was there definite criteria set up? I wasn't familiar with it.
Yes, they did.
Yes, they have.
The careers committee did. They outlined the things. There were about 11 points on there that they stressed, and they were going to ask the other sections to give suggestions, but they never brought it forward as a recommendation. It was merely discussed. But they did, they set up a criteria of about 11 qualifications there, and the careers committee and the program committee made the final decision last year, just before the ceremony, the day before the ceremony, because I had to watch the newspapers to keep it from being released.
Well, how can people nominate if they don't know what the criteria is?
Well, this is one of those things, I mean, I know the first time of it, it was a question. And I don't know really how. we have a motion. Is there a second? The Fifth District GSNA Board hold up the ballot on Nurse of the Year Award and keep nominations open until May 1, is that right? Is there a second?
And is there any way that you can find out from what Mrs. Susan says in terms of the set policy this year with our being able to see what the criteria selection is, what have you, or is it too late to do that?
Well, I don't...
I have the things that they set up last year, and if they'd like to have a mimeographed copy of that and sent out to all the hospitals and health agencies and groups and all, we can do that and tell them that those were the qualifications that were used as, for last year and that will be used at this time if they want to go ahead and use the same one, and that they welcome suggestions and that a definite program will be planned for next year and announced with all the details. I don't think we can go ahead and make all the announcements now that we're in the middle of it, that we'd start doing that, but we can go ahead and tell them that if you want to, that it has been delayed until May 1st and that nominations would be accepted until then, and that they give the ones that the committee are using at the present time as a criteria.
Well, do you know, happen to know what the...
I have them all written down from the meeting, but I couldn't tell you all of it. One of them's leadership and a professional qualification. Is she a happy person? Is she outward? What has she done to the profession? Has she contributed anything from the leadership? I mean, in other words, is she tactful? It just goes down the line of the things that you'd make a good nurse, the qualifications for a very outstanding person who not only is a good professional person, but is also a good citizen. So I have all of those down from that meeting of the last year, the things that were discussed and added to the ones that were discussed the first year. But no one ever made the recommendation. They were going to ask all the sections to give their suggestions for that and that it be formulated and made into a policy procedure.
Don't you think that if we're going to have qualifications for this criteria set up, that they should be submitted to the board and the board approve them and these be set and kept that way instead of the committee each year changing to suit their own ideas? Because every year we'll have different ideas to what the nurse of the year should be. And I think that everybody should be free to give suggestions, but the decision should be up to the board. And once they set up, I don't think they should be changed by the committee. I think they should have that freedom.
And I think that, too, that when we start planning this program each year, that the criteria should be published in the district meter every year so that everybody has the criteria to know what they're looking for in a person.
It could even include the vote in the district meter, the criteria and what the vote done, and kind of send it in. Is there any further discussion on this motion? Would it be held up until the 1st of May?
Question.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
do we want to send recommendations to this committee, or do we, does the board want to? Do anything further about at this time?
I mean, actually, I would like it if, as Sister had stated it, I mean, that this, that the, it be established, if this is in order by this group and that the criteria be acted upon by the group and the coach.
You want to speak on that up? Well, I tell you what I have in mind, since I've been in office, Stanley, I've been hoping that we could adopt the manual from the state and make everything that applies to our standing committees and special committees have a set policy, procedure, and go down the line. When a person is appointed, send it to them, and here it is. So I thought at the convention, at the meeting we're going to have in New York, if I didn't get the information before then, I'd get everything I could on standing committees, responsibilities, and the detailed information, and that we make us up a manual in Fifth District, and in so doing it, maybe we could do all of this at one time. That would take care of all the committees, and then it wouldn't be pointed, it wouldn't, no one should feel hurt about it or feel that it was out of line. I think we've gone so far right now that if we tried to do this right in the middle of it, that we'd lead to complications. But that has been our, and Ms. DeGarland knows that we've talked about it and that we've been trying to get all the material that we could, particularly on nominations. There's so many little questions that come up about that, and they recommended last year that we have it spelled out. If the sections and the other groups don't send us in nominees, are we supposed to do it? Or how are we to, what are we to do when we don't have them? And I feel that if in July, when we do go to the American Nurses, in the meantime, we get all the information we can, and maybe y'all give us a good committee to work with us on policies and procedures, and we'll have us a manual. And
we've been allowed to step forth in your allies already.
Yes, but it isn't enough. It doesn't cover it. There are too many loopholes in there. We take bylaws and start from there and enlarge on it to where every phase of it is covered, where there will be no word by mouth or someone does it this time and next time we change. Miss Wells, you had an order of that way back down about 3 years ago on that when they were just planning neighborhood dinners. According to the minutes there, that there was a committee supposed to be headed by the executive secretary on that.
And I think past presidents would make a good committee. Definite criteria to be set up for choosing the nurse of the year. These criteria should be approved by the board of the Fifth District GSNA and not be subject to change by the committee unless the changes are first approved by the board. Is there any discussion on this?
further discussion on this motion? Those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
That's the method of selection, isn't it?
We've got another motion coming up, thank you, bye. We're gonna talk about you.
We still got important business going on up here. Just playing around.
Leaving the first to last. It's surprising that all the special committees got real ambitious, had held meetings and came up with recommendations that were.
Here's your recommendation I was referring to. It was a recommendation made back there on a call meeting July 23rd that a study be made of the total 5th district programs, work of all committees, set up a manual for the committees. And the motion was made that a committee on committees be appointed to study the total program procedures of the district, and a manual for the committees be presented to the executive board. And then the motion was made to appoint the executive secretary as chairman of this committee on committees, and she'd be empowered to appoint her committee. Anyway, we do want to work on it, whatever you say.
It must have been late.
What was the date of that?
7, I think. It was during the time you were planning your neighborhood dinners. Wait a minute, I'll tell you. July 23rd, 1959.
Yes, they went through that. I know who made that motion.
I know you
they went through that siege of motion of committees on committees.
Well, just give us one good committee.
And I know who did it. Committees on committees.
That the president appoint a committee to work on a manual for the 5th district outlining the duties and responsibilities of each committee. That the board approve the manual and that a copy of the responsibilities be sent to committee chairman and members each year. Is there any further discussion on this? Those in favor, please say aye. Contrary, no.
Motion to your office.
We have a report from the Committee on Professional Nursing Practice. You remember, this is a new committee. The name has been changed from, what was it exactly?
Well, it's been on professional practice ever since I've been there, the 3 years.
It was changed from this improper practice.
Improper practice to professional practice. You want to read this one? The committee met at the Fulton County Health Department on March 7, 1963 at 2:30 p.m. Those present were Maddie Lee Wade, chairman, Margaret Wicker, Mildred Price, Gladys Garland, ex officio, absent Mrs. Louise Vaughn. Prior to the meeting, copies of the ANA booklet committee on the resolution on nursing practice were circulated to the members by the chairman. Those attending the meeting were given a copy of the ANA 1961 survey findings on violations of the Code for Professional Nurses, which, in addition to information on the most frequent violations of the code, rep-
supported by state nurses associations, included a suggested form for reporting violations. After reviewing the ANA guides to SNS work for this committee, it was felt a statement of functions was needed from the 5th District GSNA before realistic goals could be set. Attached is a letter directed to Mrs. Gladys Garland, President, 5th District GSNA, who in turn forwarded to this committee. With the increased demand for nurses, the Committee on Professional Nursing Practice requests the Board of Directors, 5th District GSNA, to consider asking the State Board of Examiners of Nurses for Georgia to evaluate present policy in regards to instances pointed up in the letter and make adjustments where possible without lowering standards. I'll read you the letter. Dear Mrs. Garland, this letter is from Margaret Bodica, Director of Nursing Service, Henry Eggleston Hospital for Children. Mr. McLemore tells me he was discussing one of our problems with you the other day and that you are interested in knowing some of the details. I am quite concerned about this problem, and of course Mr. McLemore, as Administrator of Eggleston, is concerned too. Ms. Celia Vernon received her B.S. in nursing from the University of Virginia School of Nursing in June 1962. She passed the Virginia State Board and came to Eggleston Hospital as a pediatric staff nurse September 17, 1962. Ms. Vernon made application for licensure by endorsement in Georgia soon after her arrival. She was issued a temporary license, was told she would not be able to be licensed in Georgia because of a deficiency in clinical experience, namely operating room scrubs. Ms. Vernon had a conference with Mrs. Jones and I think met with the board. After these conferences, Ms. Vernon became quite discouraged. She asked that her application be withdrawn, resigned from our staff on December 31, 1962, and returned to Virginia. Her friend and classmate, Miss Ruby Jakeman, had a similar experience. She resigned from Emory University Hospital staff in December. Miss Janice Dameron received her B.S. in nursing from the University of Tennessee School of Nursing in June 1962. She passed the Tennessee State Board during the summer and became a member of our nursing staff June 22, 1962. Ms. Dameron applied for licensure in Georgia and was given a temporary license, but was notified by letter that Georgia requirements are that nurses have experience of 42 to 56 days in the operating room, including the assistants with 25 operations, of which one half will be scrubs. Ms. Dameron, of course, was very upset and quite concerned. We were able, however, to persuade her to remain on the staff, hoping she could eventually be licensed. Ms. Dameron tells me that she received her permanent license from the State Board of Nurses Examiners several days ago. We are actively recruiting for nurses interested in pediatrics. We have contacted the collegiate schools of nursing in the surrounding states. In fact, most of the collegiate programs in the country have been made aware of our needs. It certainly seems too bad that when we succeed in interesting young graduates in our program, they are refused licensure and have a great deal of difficulty. This is true, especially in view of the fact that these are schools of nursing accredited by the National League of Nursing. I am also concerned about our future in the area of recruitment. The deans of both of these schools know their graduates have had this difficulty here in Georgia. Helen Graves and I talked at length with Mrs. Jones. We also met with the Board of Nurse Examiners in December. I was quite discouraged and felt that there was very
Since we are the only children's hospital in Georgia, we feel our responsibility not only for patient care, but for providing an environment for graduate and undergraduate nurses to improve their skills in nursing care of sick children. Thank you for your interest in our problem. I should be glad to go over this with you in more detail if you feel this would be helpful. Since this letter came to me on the 16th of February, almost a month before meeting of this board, I referred it to the Committee on Professional Nursing Practice, and as I have reported to you, they met on the 7th of March. The committee have recommended that if at this time adjustments cannot be made, the committee requests consideration be given by the state board to exert every effort to establish through available local resources facilities to which applicants with similar deficiencies may go for the additional work required by the state board. As you can see in this report, this committee also would like guidance and direction as to how far they should go on a problem such as this, and within what framework they should work.
Well, the rules and regulations that are out, I mean, referred to as the Blue Book, 1950 vintage, revised in 1953, is the one that this still reads. There's been no revision. That we have is the faculty gone over the rules and regulations at least twice, you know, as the standards of this, but still waiting for publication, and I don't know if that's an area that can be changed or not. Both of the girls mentioned ABS.
I would like to add one more to that. We had a girl come to us from the University of South Carolina with a BS in nursing, and her license was held up, but I just made her keep going down there fighting for it. And she finally got it, but she was held up for several months, and she was quite upset. I don't think would have stayed at all except when her husband was going to school here. But I just kept insisting that she go back down there. And she did.
This problem is far reaching in just 5th district, because there are collegiate programs being established throughout the country. And I think we have evidence here of just the states mentioned. There are several different states coming into Georgia. They do be registered within the state or the practice within the state. So it's not just going to be the district that has the problem, but the entire state. And I think that when we have recruitment, trying to get nurses into Georgia and in town, this type of problem, they're going back home, because many of them do not feel after spending 4 to 5 years in nursing, receiving a degree in nursing, and being registered in another state, that they would feel at liberty
this business at $25. We don't even have to show on our final record whether or not the student had scrubs.
That's just something that looks to me like they must have cooked up.
Sister, I mean, are you using the new form?
You can use, reuse the form, but you don't have to put on the evidence.
But you have to take that new form down and have the board of examiners to approve it. I had to do this last year. I only learned it.
Well, I'm using the same form I've been using for the last 3 years. I haven't had
it. Yeah, but you...
I still sent the same ones in the summer.
You did the old form on it, had a practice grade and a theory grade. The new form has only one. And
that's all right.
State faculty meeting in, where was it, in Savannah last year, I learned that I had to submit this for approval to the board. And I brought the thing down to the board. And I mean, they were most gracious. But I have a whole form that has to go on the back of my final record, and it has the number of scrubs, and the number of circulations, and the amount of night duty, and the amount of day duty.
Well, really? That's on the front of our record, but this business of how many scrubs, we're not trying to teach them the skill of being a scrub nurse. If they want that, they have to get that out of their graduate. We want to educate them so far as what they can learn in the operating room, but not the skill of scrubbing.
But Sister, you know,
that's ridiculous.
In addition to this, I mean, you've received the communication from the board.
I just sent it to the
I don't have any. I ran out of them. I had a bottle 2 years ago, so I ran into it this past year. But then we're supposed to put a 3x3 photo, which I think is excellent. But then we're supposed to give an evaluation. And I found out that this is supposed to be similar to the clinical grade. And I mean, I made a declaration at the faculty meeting of the Academy of Medicine there that, I mean, our final grade is the composite of the clinical and theory grade. And they said that I just have to make this stage onto the form. But it is coming up as it relates to this newer form system.
Well, I do think we ought to protest this to somebody. I think it is ridiculous. We have a 300 passing score on the state board, and then have the nerve to refuse the registration for those girls who come in here from collegiate programs. Our friends have got the National League, and we're the only state in the union that has 300 passing. Everybody else has at least 350.
Madam Chair.
Our graduates with a passing score in Georgia are not eligible for reciprocity in any state in the United States. Nice to make over 350, but they can nurse in Georgia. So we really kind of feel ridiculous. I'm the mother.
I have another concern that's bothering me. And we've had a number of students who are in the school just a year and dropping out and becoming a licensed undergraduate. This child has had 9 months of the freshman period of the program, 1/4 and a few weeks into the 2nd quarter, which puts her eligible in Georgia to apply for this examination. And it's the grades that she graduated, that she has been in a school that had pediatrics and obstetrics in it. This child has had none. Yet I
they have any, I mean, do they, are there rules that they go by? Or they just decide that these people can't be licensed?
Was that this is something that the nurses should do for themselves.
But the board?
Now, they can do it for us, right, quick right. And they might have a quicker way of doing this than we would, but I think that they would like to see nurses take care of their problems.
Give us an opportunity
to do it.
What could they do?
to legislatures.
Well, that's,
yeah,
that's
what I'll change.
That's what I thought you had.
Well, the thing that I cannot understand is how we have a person on there who embezzled $17,000 with her jail sentence, and that was carried to the office, the state board office, the photostatic copies, and that person, nothing has been done about her license. She's tried to get in again through another hospital by letting someone else pay her dues, and she is not eligible for membership. Yet she is still registered in the state of Georgia, and we have a letter last month that no action has been taken on that. Yes, she is. And she's divorcing the fourth husband now, so she's going back the other name, but she's still, that's true. We have her application that came in, and she is not eligible because she caused the bylaws to be changed last September, making it so.
Miss Garland, what do we need? Do we need some sort of a motion to go to the state? We have a meeting, we couldn't. When is the next?
Madam Chair, I thought this was presented to the Fifth District Committee on Professional Practice. If we might not ask the State Committee on Professional Practice to help us with this, because this is a problem that affects the entire state, not just the district, I think we do need to look a little further and ask for some assistance and see which direction we go now.
We have to have it in writing.
Give Jean one too, all right.
Well, I'm not quite sure what we want to do, but this thought came to mind that possibly the State Committee on Professional Practice would be interested in this problem too. Now, we'd be best for us to
Now, they've never had a meeting. That committee was stopped.
We don't want to borrow it, you know, the word.
No, we don't.
We need to look at the ramifications.
If we recommend to the state committee, then it would really have to wait for the state convention for it to be acted on. Because that committee would have to report to the state, and that can only be done at convention. Is that not true?
I don't think publishing in the media would
no,
be there. I think that your committee have the support of the board here, that they get all the information they can on the codes that are set up and they know exactly what is required. Get the information from the State Board of Examiners and have something thorough, something to go on, know how they stand on it, and to be sure that the facts are there.
Well, since this is a problem in the Fifth District and everywhere else too, but it's brought to the why couldn't? Now I guess we couldn't do anything about legislation without taking in the whole state because it's state law.
State law.
Mm-hmm. State law doesn't set up the qualifications.
Uh-huh. I know, but I mean it would be a state.
They don't, the legislature don't even know what our qualifications are.
No, that's not what I mean. I mean it would involve the whole Georgia State Nurses Association, any change in our law that the Fifth District could not change the law by itself, so it would have to go.
Have to go to the legislative committee.
And yes, it would have to go to the state meeting, no matter what.
That's
we
not until next November. That's what I was just thinking of this board because imminent problem right now.
We could work on it and take a recommendation.
I don't know that it's even an all law whether or not we should do it without first consulting, you know, the state. But it does seem a shame that these girls have been discouraged, and to lose two in one summer is a big problem because she has a hard time recruiting for pediatrics.
Well, that makes them also, they're not eligible for membership in the American Nurses Association.
Well,
if they are not registered in the state, so it directly concerns the 5th District too. But their membership.
Weren't the legislative committee of the district and the state also the, what was this committee?
Professional practice.
Why couldn't the four committees have a joint meeting?
The legislative committee would not be concerned with this.
Well, they'd have to get legislation.
The state law does not set up the qualifications for registration as a registered nurse in Georgia. That is done by the vote. Your state law, of course, governs those who are registering as a registered nurse, but not as a criteria for being qualified to nurse as a registered nurse. That's the responsibility of the executive board.
They set the code and or the governing body, but they do not set the policies or the criteria.
You're talking about the Board of Examiners now.
That's the Board of Examiners.
They do not set the criteria.
Board of Examiners
does.
And they have to meet certain requirements that are set up by the National Board of Examiners.
Sounds like we need a lawyer.
Well, it seems to me like you need some facts first to just find out what they do require. I mean, how do they base their endorsements? And
it seems to me that the best thing that could be done would to ask your Committee on Professional Practice for a meeting with the Executive Board and Mr. Clifton, who is responsible for the board and for the actions of the board, and for the thing to be talked over and see what it is, what their requirements are. Where they come from, but they've got them. I'm sure they had some reason somewhere for making this.
How do you feel about somebody meeting with Mr. Clifton and the board from 5th District?
That committee, what's wrong with them? That's their responsibility.
Yeah, I mean that committee, to meet with them. And take the letter and discuss the problem.
This is a good idea to go to Mr. Clifton instead.
I think the board ought to be there.
The board and Mr. Clifton. And this committee will meet.
What committee is this?
Professional practice.
Who's on that
committee?
Maggie Wade's chairman, Margaret Wickham, Mildred Price, and Judy Bone. Well, they want some direction from the executive board where it has to see them, this committee.
On the state level, you've got a good many of the people who are on the state committee who are here in the district. Of course, there are other members on that committee who are in the other state the districts. But I don't know that this is going to help the district bring in the state committee.
Who all was on that committee?
I don't remember who all was on that. Mary Woody is chairman. The members of the State Board of Examiners, and I think there's about around 20 people on that committee.
I believe the district president.
district.
Could we have them see it and the state people see it?
Any time a state committee is involved, it does have to go to the convention, doesn't it?
No.
Does not?
Can have to go to the convention, it would, what the other thing is, they would make a report back to the state board of GS and then. If Ms. Wood's committee was brought in, then she would make a report to the state board.
And they could act without the membership, know anything about?
The state executive board to, for this.
I believe we'd have FUCA action if you just got the local committed on this and then.
I think the local committee needs to do more work before you come in the state committee.
And then for it.
I think the state committee certainly should have a report from this committee as to what is going on.
What is the name of this committee again?
Committee on Professional Practice.
Madam Chairman, I move that the Committee on Professional Practice meet with Mr. Clinton and the Board of Examiners to discuss this problem. Shall I spell out the problem?
I expect you there for the.
Well, I've already written a letter for Ms. Margaret Belka, Director of Nursing Service at Eccleston's Children's Hospital concerning licensure of nurses coming to Georgia from other states who hold BS degrees who have been denied
state
licensure. Read that.
I added to discuss the problem explained in the letter from Ms. Boak.
I said.
You just didn't set up the committee, that's all.
We voted on that.
Yes,
We voted.
That was passed.
We just hadn't set up the committee yet. If anybody has a burning desire to do some work, well, I'm sure the fact is we like to.
I think your past presidents would be a good one to work with it on that.
Well, they certainly have
Ms.
been
Dixon.
Through this. Did we have a report from Ms. Graves' committee? She's had a meeting, I know.
She hasn't reported to us.
On functions of ANA?
No, but in case some of you wondered how you got all that wonderful material from ANA, we got it through 5th District. And we asked that it's, they send it directly to you. And we got one for each member of the board, and then we have three to circulate. We first got two, and we got submitted demands or requests for it for other members until they could order theirs. I mean, for instance, Ms. Garen and some of the others. So all members of the board have it, and all members of the committee have complete sets, and we have two if anyone would like to use them. Well, we sent, we saved postage on that too. We sent the, on the back of the meter and asked them if it was possible that we thought the direct contact from ANA would be helpful. And had I known they'd do it, I would have probably added the committee name too.
You didn't send it to anybody you thought wouldn't read it though, did you?
No.
Is there any new business?